via our Facebook Live, so that if your colleagues or in your network would like to view it but was not able to register, they can visit our Facebook page, and these get streamed live on our Facebook page at Erudite Philippines OPC. So, hi, Jules. All right.
Good morning, Wins. Good morning.
Yes, that would be good morning for you. It's
good afternoon for you.
All right. So it's 2:30, and as I promised, we'll be starting on time. Mary Joy, my colleague, will be the one to admit them as they come in. Okay. So welcome to our webinar on using data to make maintenance more predictable. So today is October 21, 2021. And this will be facilitated by Jules Oudmans. And we hope that you will take this time to maximize the learning by sharing your insights, participating in our polls, as well as putting in your questions. So we have a chat room where you can put in your questions, and we would love to address them at the end of the webinar. Okay. So before I turn you over to Jules, I would like to introduce to you our company. So our company is Erudite Philippines, and we are the technology partner of U-Reason in the Philippines. So these are the different brands that we are representing in the Philippines. We are primarily doing international certification, preparation, trainings. And this particular course is geared towards an Industry 4.0 and making data in your maintenance that could be used to make it more predictable. So if in any questions that you have about how you can avail the services of U-Reason, you may course it through us. And you know, everyone has been hit hard about this pandemic, but we are still very grateful that our clients have trusted us in spite of the difficulty in doing trainings online. And you see these faces on screen. They have entrusted our company to provide them this technical training. I'm very glad to announce that some of the participants that you see here on the screen have actually recently passed our Certified Maintenance and Reliability Professional exam by SMRP. So even if it's an online training, they were able to prepare well for that internationally recognized certification. Okay. So a little bit about U-Reason. U-Reason is an independent provider of next generation asset performance management software. They are combining AI with your and our expertise. So U-Reason started in 2001 by AI pioneer. So we're very lucky that we have Jules with us, who has been in the industry and AI for a long time. And they are the first movers, the pioneers, right, Jules?
Yeah, absolutely. And
they have success stories that he would love to share with us later on. So with their experience, we combine it with the process and engineering background in artificial intelligence. So he will also share with you the technology that is called APM Studio. Okay. So for the benefit of our participants, I would like to take this time to introduce our facilitator for this webinar. So his name is Jules Oudmans. Hi, Jules.
All right. Hey, Wins. Hey, everyone.
Everybody can hear you. Great. So Jules is one of the co-founders of U-Reason, a provider of technology products and services, enabling companies to quickly create intelligent applications that automate the complex reasoning on large quantities of real-time data and events. Jules is a seasoned professional active in the field of operational intelligence and real-time analytics. He has set vision and supported early adopters and co-visionaries in oil and gas, petrochemical, utilities, pulp and paper, defense and telecom industries at companies such as Halliburton, BP, Motorola, Siemens, Shell, Cargill, Leondale, and BG Transco. So this, even, you know, you can see the big companies worldwide have trusted and trusting U-Reason for this technology. Jules has a broad range of experience in consultancy, project development, and project management roles for customers and prospective customers through Europe, the Middle East, and North America. So I will not keep you anymore, and I will turn you over to Jules. So Jules.
Thank you, Wins, for the introduction. Sure. I shall share my screen. And that should hopefully turn on the sharing okay.
Yes, Jules, we can see it.
You can see it perfectly. Okay. Again, hello, everyone. Welcome to the webinar. This webinar hosted by Erudite. In this webinar, I will explain how we can use data to make maintenance processes more predictable, and what the typical process flow is for asset performance management projects. Now, this webinar consists of four parts. First, I will provide a brief introduction on the company Urizen. Secondly, we'll have a look at the typical work processes for asset performance management solutions. And then we will actually see an example in action as well. And this is followed by a Q&A session. So during the entire webinar, if you have any questions, put them in the chat window, like Wins already indicated. And then towards the end of the webinar, so there's some slides, then there is a demonstration towards the end of the webinar. There will be about 20, 30 minutes of Q&A time as well. So a brief, I'm just waiting for the slide to progress. There we go. A brief introduction. Wins already did most of it. I'm Jules Zoetmans presenting to you today. I have a background in AI starting in the 90s, and I've been involved many times in the past 25 years in prognostic and predictive programs that ensure asset integrity for critical assets and critical processes. Here are my contact details. If you have any questions after the webinar, don't hesitate to email me or get in contact, of course, with Wins from Erudite. I work at Urizen. Urizen is a software company, also one of the founders, and we provide solutions for real-time condition-based and predictive maintenance applications. And on a day-to-day basis, I help our customers to use our software from data analysis to the setup of applications and solutions that monitor important assets and processes. At Urizen, we combine our domain expertise and software knowledge with our customers, and I help them, our customers, from data to solutions. We have offices in Rotterdam in the Netherlands, which we see here in the picture, and you can see here in the back as well. And Reading in the UK, and our customers are predominantly in the manufacturing and process industries, with the majority of them located in Western Europe and the Northern Americas. We also work in Asia. We have a number of customers like Huntsman, PTT, EP, etc. Urizen is active in the real-time condition monitoring, predictive and prescriptive maintenance domain. Our field of operation is from helping customers to insights into data, to helping asset owners, OEMs, and maintenance service organizations with data-driven maintenance solutions. Very often we start together with our customers and our partners to define the business case and use cases to focus on, followed by data collection, model development and deployment, and then deploying those solutions into the existing OT and IT landscape. Now, to get to know you a little bit better, you being the audience, let me ask you a question. So I'm going to start a poll. And this should hopefully be visible in your screen. I'm battling a little bit here with the dual screens. So The question I'm asking is what is your current maintenance strategy for critical assets? It's a single choice entry. So let me know if you have a reactive or maybe a preventive or condition-based, or maybe if you're already doing predictive maintenance or prescriptive maintenance, just to get you to know you a little bit better. The answers are coming in. And the majority of you, about 50%, is doing preventative maintenance. which is very typical. I mean, we encounter that a lot with our customers. The traditional way of doing maintenance. Some of you are doing already condition-based and predictive maintenance in the responses I can see. So it's a very diverse audience, you could say. Most of you are still in the area of doing preventive maintenance. So maybe doing too much maintenance or having too many maintenance activities scheduled and keeping your assets up to a certain quality level, which is good, of course, but using the data of your assets, you may be able to save time or to prolong the planned maintenance intervals by a certain extent. Okay, thanks for your answers. So I know a little bit about you. You know a little bit about me now as well. So I introduced in the beginning that we're a software company, and our software APM Studio is actually used at different levels in the automation pyramid. We run embedded very often, of course, with OEMs like Siemens and Kone, Endos and Hauser, monitoring faults and risks in isolation to the asset. An asset can be instrumentation, an actuator, a pump, a compressor, a filter, etc. We also deploy our software at the edge, i.e. in the control cabinets near to the PLCs, processing asset data of one or multiple assets to run condition monitoring and predictive applications near to where the data is generated, and preventing the heavy load of the data to on-premise or on-premise and cloud systems. We also, of course, work at level 2 and 3, where APM is used to monitor faults and relationships in relation to the process, where we deploy or run on on-premise compute most often. And when deployed at level 4 and level 5, APM Studio is typically used for optimizing the maintenance cost and planning associated to an asset base supporting a process at one or multiple locations. Your reason's value lies in the fact that we have domain expertise in different areas and in different industrial processes. And also in the fact that our software allows you, it's a little bit hidden in the name, allows you to reason with your real-time data and event. And it's a no-code or low-code environment, which is quite easy to understand. And I will show this later on as well. There's a lot of building blocks for configuration, allowing you to quickly create intelligent solutions that reason over data, which can be easily deployed across a variety of different deployment levels and deployment targets. Our characteristics as a company are that we share our knowledge and capabilities in the field of real-time analytics with our customers. And we very often help our customers, OEMs and asset owners, in the co-development of Industry 4.0 applications. We're not a system integrator or a consultancy company, we're a software company. And we also quite heavily participate in different industry groups and standardization initiatives, such as the Open Industry 4 Alliance, ISA, and MUA, for example. Now, let me ask you a question again to better understand your motivation to join this webinar. So I'm launching it here. So did you join this webinar to evaluate for certain assets if you can move to condition-based maintenance programs, or maybe to predictive maintenance programs, or maybe even to prescriptive maintenance programs? So prescriptive maintenance programs are all about providing field personnel with the right actions to take given the current condition of the machine or the asset. Predictive maintenance programs are, of course, all about understanding where you are on the PF curve with respect to the failure and the time to failure, such that you can optimize the planning. And condition-based maintenance programs are very often with our customers a starting point where customers would like to better understand what the current and now current integrity is of their assets to make the right choices. And the right choices with respect to inspections, maintenance activities to be carried out, etc. So I can see here in the poll that there is it's a 50-50 between people in the audience. Actually, it's a 60-40 now attending the webinar to see how they can apply condition-based maintenance program. And there's also part of the audience that is interested to see how they can go to a predictive maintenance program. So I'll try to answer actually all three of these questions here in this webinar and take you along the process as well of how to achieve this. Thank you again for your inputs. So if you're an OEM, so if there's OEMs in the audience, your motivation could be to provide condition-based or predictive or prescriptive capabilities to your customers. Of course, if you're an asset owner, you're much more concerned about your process and your assets that are supporting your process. Now, let me take you through the typical APM project flow, which actually applies to condition-based, predictive, and prescriptive programs. If we look at the asset performance management flow for projects and for new OEM solutions as well, they apply to both, so both to the asset owners and the OEMs. We typically start with selecting an asset that is of importance to the process or of importance to the asset owner or the OEM. And for that asset, we collect data, and I'll come back to that later on in the slide on what data we actually collect. And based on the data that is collected for functional degradations and failures, we or the customer starts a modeling phase to determine if the data that is collected, that is available, can be used to provide enhanced or early insights on asset degradations. Now, depending on the success of the modeling phase, we can also go from the modeling phase to the deployment phase, actually deploying the models that have been maybe trained and validated on the data on live streaming data, so that you have 24/7 guard looking over the asset integrity of your assets. The project activities of asset selection, data collection, and modeling are all offline. Offline meaning that you don't have to be connected to the machines or directly to the data historians or the SCADA systems or the DCS from which you collect the data. Once you're satisfied with the solution, you should consider, of course, deploying it such that you have 24/7 monitoring. And APM Studio, our software, is a deployment environment, which I will show more on a little bit later also in the demo. Now, let's have a look at a typical project flow in more detail. We have selected a pump for this example. I think most of you can recognize or have pumps at your site. So if during the asset selection, it became clear that a pump or a number of pumps are critical to your operations and they are supporting your business case, it's a good asset to start with. But you shouldn't start with all the different failure modes and functional degradation mechanisms of your pump. For the selected assets, you should identify the most likely failure mechanisms and modes that are most critical to the failures on the basis of FMEA or FMECA information. So for example, if we take the pump, one of the failure modes for degradations is a reduction of the suction head, which could be caused by cavitation, which may lead to a loss of the pump efficiency. So for the selected asset or assets, we go through the FMEAs or the FMECAs, and we do a criticality analysis to determine the RPNs, risk priority numbers, and we focus on the failures and the functional degradations that matter the most, i.e. that matter the most in the sense of time, downtime, cost, and hours that are spent on it. And when you know the failures and the functional failure degradations that matter the most, we plot them against the frequency at which these can occur and against the associated downtime, which may have costs or risks associated to them. And we typically create APM condition-based monitoring solutions for assets, degradations, and failures that sit in quadrant number 3, Q3 here in this picture. And predictive maintenance solutions for asset degradations and failures that sit in quadrant number 4, Q4 in the picture. Quadrant number 1 means that you have a very high failure frequency and a very high downtime. If you have many of those, it's typically down to design or modifications. And quadrant number 2, which we also see in the picture, which has a high failure frequency, but the downtime associated with it is relatively low, or you have a parallel process is an area where you typically invest in preventive maintenance programs. Now, let me ask you a question again about what your biggest driver is for starting a condition-based or a predictive maintenance program. Go to start here, poll number three. So it should pop up on your screen. What are the biggest drivers for you to consider starting condition-based or predictive maintenance programs? Is it a reduction of the maintenance cost, or perhaps it's a reduction of the unplanned downtime, or maybe lower energy costs, or maybe there's other reasons as well. And you have to choose the most dominant reason for doing this. So unfortunately, you can only make one choice. I understand that in certain cases, multiple choices would apply, i.e. unplanned downtime, maintenance cost, reducing on the energy cost, etc. So in the lead is unplanned downtime prevention, which we see at our customers as well, independent of industry, is a topic, that has a lot of interest. Unplanned downtime, unscheduled downtime, as sometimes it's called unscheduled downtime, is an area where companies can improve, where companies can make the difference, the marginal difference on making a profit or being break even, or even not being break even but making a loss. So unplanned downtime for us is most of the cases the predominant reason for starting a condition-based or predictive maintenance program. Again, thanks for your answers. And let me skip the slide there. Actually, a few. I scrolled forward. So when you know what failures and degradations to focus on, we use the structure of the ISO 13374 to guide you, the customers, through the process from data collection, data acquisition, to the solutions. We start with data acquisition. We determine if certain data needs to be manipulated. First, we acquire it, of course, needs to be manipulated, and if states in the data, processing states, are important. If we take the example of the centrifugal pump, state detection is actually quite important because you don't want to have certain models or processing rules running in states where the pump is ramping up or down or not available. Now, on the basis of the data that is available, the states that have been identified, we determine if the health can be notified early to the users. And on the basis of the functional degradation and failure data, we determine if prognostic assessments can also be provided. So prognostics are what nowadays are called predictive maintenance. And this area has been around for a very long time. And this ISO standard can also help you and guide you in doing a structured way of doing asset performance management applications. Now, the data that is collected is actually collected from multiple systems. You collect data from your process systems, SCADA, DCS systems, PLC systems, where you focus on the historical data from your data historians, SPI, IP21, ExaQuantum, PhD, etc. And you should not only look at the process data that is available, but also at the alarm and event data that is available, because very often this data source, the alarm and event data, contains a lot of valuable information on specific disruptions that you had in your process, which may be related also to your assets. Next to the process data, you also need to collect data from your enterprise asset management systems or your CMMS systems, where you get an overview of the historical records of work orders, inspection results, preventive and corrective maintenance tasks that have been carried out, which then later on are mapped against the process data to see if there's a correlation and causality between the maintenance that was carried out or the inspections that were carried out and the actual performance of the equipment and the performance degradation. Now, failure data, the third category of data, is also very important, but very often we find that customers do not have a structured manner or structured way in which they store failure data. So sometimes there are spreadsheets, sometimes there's an OEE database, or there are even other data sources that provide us with functional degradations and failure data that we can use to train models with. So based on the data that is being collected of the failure mechanisms and the failures that we want to detect early, we actually make a step back to the FMEA or the FMECA, and we identify where or from which sources you can get the data to actually classify, detect the different failure mechanisms. So if you want to determine that cavitation is currently occurring at a pump, which could cause a loss of efficiency, but also an increased erosion of the impeller, you identify where or from which data sources you can obtain the data that is needed. If you take the first row in this table, for example, the data may be available in your process historian, such as suction pressure, discharge pressure flow, energy consumption, etc. And failures may be logged in an OEE database, the performance of the pump. And in certain cases, failures and functional degradations are logged in records that are found in the maintenance management systems or other sources as well. And based on the data that is collected, we typically determine if there is sufficient data available to start a predictive maintenance program with. Very often there is insufficient data to reach a certain accuracy level of the prediction of the failure mechanisms that are occurring, taking place. And if you cannot reach over a minimum accuracy of 80%, we advise our customers to stay with real-time condition-based maintenance solutions and strengthen the way in which failures are being recorded so that they can make a step towards a predictive maintenance solution later on. Real-time condition-based maintenance solutions are very often a good starting point for a lot of our customers. And I also saw this in the poll that that we ran, that for many of you, starting with real-time condition-based maintenance solution is a very good starting point. Now, when there is enough or sufficient failure and functional degradation data, and you can typically make the step towards a predictive maintenance program and train models that can recognize the upset and oncoming of certain failures, but also do survival analysis on your data to predict the time to event. So predictive maintenance is all about knowing where you are on the PF curve and then predicting the time to event. So when there is sufficient data, we can provide predictive maintenance solutions that predict the piece and provide sufficient time for the maintenance organization to plan the replacement or maintenance activities on the assets. We determine if the data that is available and the amount of data that is available is sufficient to classify the potential failures, the piece, with a high enough accuracy. If there's sufficient failure data and functional degradation data available, then we use regression models and survival analysis models to determine what the actual PF interval is, i.e. the time between the detection of a P, a potential failure, which could be a functional degradation, for example, and the actual failure occurring on the asset. And this allows you to identify, prioritize, plan, and schedule your maintenance activities in the right manner, so that you have no unplanned outages anymore and less failures. We also have customers that, on the basis of the detection or classification of the potential failure, would actually like to stretch the PF curve. So stretching meaning making sure that the failure, which is imminent, actually takes place at a later point in time. We, for example, have a customer in the oil and gas industry, operates a large number of electrical submersible pumps. And the logistics operations to replace these pumps is quite complex and has a very long lead time. So in that case, we detect certain potential failures, functional degradations of the submersible pumps, and we stretch the PF curve by adjusting the control of the ESP such that the failure takes place at a time when the replacement can also take place. Now, modeling, I've mentioned this a couple of times, modeling is something that has gotten a lot of attention in the last 7 to 8 years. New concepts, new terms for people working in a scientific way with data have been introduced. And there's also a lot of tools out there now that allow you to model your data and to train and validate your models, i.e. apply data science and data science algorithms on your data. Now, on the basis of the data that you've collected, the condition data, the different event episodes from your alarm and event data, the measurement data and the failure data, you can train in quite a wide variety of different tools, machine learning models that can classify, recognize, and provide you with a remaining useful lifetime indication of specific components, parts of an asset, or of the total asset. But most of these tools provide you with offline capabilities. With offline, I mean that you're training and validating models that can recognize those circumstances, but you actually want to translate the results of this to something that can continuously be used to monitor it online. There is a standard which is called PMML, which stands for Predictive Model Markup Language. That helps you in this. PMML has been around for many years. Actually, it was introduced in the late 90s. And it allows you to go from the validated machine learning models in your analysis environments to an online environment. And within APM Studio, we provide the capability to run machine learning models that you have trained and validated in your analysis environment live on the streaming data coming from your control systems, coming from your assets. So let's say you have data for the failure of your pump, and you've trained it to recognize cavitation and certain other failures. You can actually make this live within APM Studio by exporting it as a PMML in your analysis environment. And in APM, you can run then these PMML models, these machine learning models on the streaming data, but you can also run them in combination with deterministic knowledge models and probabilistic models. And these models actually ascertain what the likelihood is of certain parts, components of your assets or the entire asset or process failing or degrading on the basis of streaming real-time data. And this can all be put online within APM Studio, either at the device level, at the edge level, close to your assets, if you require high-frequency data, or at on-premise compute or at cloud level. Now, let me highlight the data and event streams here. They can be streaming data from Azure IoT Hub, if you're a cloud deployment, from InfluxDB, also again for cloud deployment, or MQTT, OPC, DA, UA-based data via REST APIs, and many other protocols. And the notifications that you provide on the right-hand side here can actually be notifications directly to your users, or dashboarding that is provided to your users, or it can also be an interface provided, for example, to other systems that support you and guide you in your maintenance activities. So it can be an interface to Infor-AEM, to Maximo, Ultimo, or SAP-PM, for example, or SAP-AIM. And those interfaces actually allow you to generate work orders or inspection orders that can then be scheduled for execution by the maintenance department or automatically scheduled if the possibility is there to do this. Now, the different deployment architectures that you can establish within APM Studio are quite diverse. It really depends on your business requirements. So we can do dashboards, but we can also integrate straight into your existing maintenance management systems. One of the deployment options is also to allow the predictive models to generate work orders that are automatically scheduled in your maintenance management system. It depends a little bit on the type of maintenance management system you have, but most of the systems allow this nowadays. Another deployment model is, of course, also providing notifications that can go out to your field personnel servicing the asset in question, providing automated cause consequence tags to help them and guide them in troubleshooting the current condition. And of course, within APM Studio, you can also create dashboards that can be embedded in your existing systems. And all the dashboards that we provide in APM Studio are web-based, so it's quite easy to embed these. Now, I will stop sharing the presentation and actually move to the demo part. But before I do the demo, let me ask you one more question. Can you let me know what challenges you face in your organization moving towards condition-based or predictive maintenance? And let me start poll here and launch this. So if you can let me know what your challenges are and what your challenges you are facing in moving your organization towards condition-based or predictive maintenance. It could be integration difficulties on the OT IT level. It could be a lack of data analytics capability within the company, or maybe even a lack of relevant data that is available, or no commitment from higher management. We sometimes encounter this as well, that companies have difficulties in justifying the business case and use cases for doing condition-based, real-time condition-based and predictive maintenance. Now, not to a surprise, the answer that is in the lead is a lack of data analytics capability. Now, in the past, I started in the field of AI back in the 90s. And at the time, it was a field that was quite exotic. The tools that we used were quite expensive. And universities were not, schools were not training people yet to work in an analytical way with data. So you had to have a mathematics or statistical background and understanding of the process from a chemical perspective, but also from a mechanical perspective of the assets, of course. So it was quite difficult at the time to use the tools and the programming languages that were available. But nowadays, and I think it's actually quite a good topic also for doing a second webinar with Erudite in the Philippines. Nowadays, there is a lot of capability. There's a lot of tools available that lower the threshold, that lower the learning threshold of actually starting to work with your own data. And I think it's one of the topics that we could maybe address in the next session to have a look at what tools are out there that enable you to manipulate your data, but also to start working with that data in a way by which you can start training and validating and but also deploying those models. Again, thanks for your inputs. And I have to move the poll out of the way here. And let me start sharing a different screen. Let me just get it up there. New share. So just checking with you that, and I'm just moving out of the way my other screen here.
You can see it?
Yep. Super, super. Okay. So I'm just moving out some of the screens here. This is APM Studio that we're looking at. So APM Studio is a web-based environment which can run on chip, on NXP and ARM chips, on edge computers, on PLCs of different vendors, but also at the control layer, on-premise, or at the cloud level. So we have multi-level deployments. And within APM Studio, you can connect to data sources. I'll show this in a little bit more detail in a minute. You can define what you have out there in the field. We also have a number of typical classes. You can model the instances of your field equipment, define alarms, alarms that help you stream and notify the right information to the right places. You can define KPIs on the overall efficiency of your assets, the performance, etc. There's state models. There's what we call processing rules that allow you to run machine learning models, but also do pre-processing of the data before you provide it, for example, to these bowtie models. Bowtie models are cause consequence models that relate or are actually associated quite closely to FMEAs and FMECAs, and of course provide decision support and dashboarding. Now the chat function and the test function here are really for developers of applications. So I'm currently logged in, as you can see here, as a super user. And as a super user, I can between quotes almost do anything, and including testing a domain and testing a model. We see in the screen here the current KPI for a number of pumps, at a specific site, where you know we see the speed, the net positive suction head, operating frequency, etc. And I can go into details on these pumps and see on the basis of the data that comes from, in this case, a hybrid DCS system and a historian, what APM Studio is actually adding to this. So APM Studio is calculating net positive suction head on the basis of the operating frequency and the RPM, the total dynamic head, and on the basis of instrumentation that the pump is connecting to also what its total dynamic head is. A pump may have a number of alarms. There's currently nothing happening here to this pump. We can zoom in or home in on the history of this pump over time. It's quite stable, but also see its current KPI with respect to energy and efficiency, and the KPI history, but also the location at which the pump currently is. So this demonstration that I'm showing here is actually of a system, a live system that is located in a city in the Netherlands called Dordrecht, where there's a flow loop that we use for different test and calibration purposes, but which is also used by industry for different innovation projects. Now, let me step through the different elements here. So we're connecting to data from the flow center here in this case, and we can see that there is multiple data points coming in for the flow, for PID, the control of the pumps, pressures and temperatures in the loop, etc. And some of these points have actually been mapped to data sources that relate to data associated to assets. There is a class model, which you can see as a kind of a template for the equipment that you have out there in the field. So we have pumps in these examples, flow transmitters, pressure transmitters, and temperature transmitters. And these classes are used to model, to create a model that represents the real installation, the real asset. So we see the pumps here, which generate a certain amount of flow, the flow transmitters, and two different MUT loops here in this flow loop, which allow us to do testings under a meter under test. There's a number of alarms defined, process alarms that look at specific behavior of the loop. And these alarms are quite straightforward. They allow you to define simple alarms, but I'll also show you how you can create alarms that actually reason over the history of the asset data that is arriving and the different models that have been trained and validated. There's a number of processing rules in the back here, the processing rules, and I forgot to mention, but within APM Studio, everything is drag and drop. It's a low-code, no-code environment. So based on our experience, based on our knowledge of also deploying these types of solutions, we have created an environment in which you can quite easily drag and drop and then configure the processing that is required for your specific cases. And all of the blocks provide these inspector windows to configure them. And there's a very extensive help library in the background as well. Let me just show you this with tons of examples in there as well. So the help library is guiding you through using APM Studio as an application to build asset performance management solutions. And there is a large number and growing number of examples that take you through, for example, monitoring performance with KPIs in a step-by-step fashion, where you get an explanation on how to define KPIs, how to configure them, et cetera. So it's quite comprehensive and quite easy to use. Typically, our users are up and running with the system in 2 to 3 days with some specific training. Now, inside this processing rule, we see start condition, and it's collecting different objects from our flow loop. And then on the basis of the objects in the flow loop, here we see that it's running a PMML model. And the PMML model is what I referenced to earlier on. It's a model that on the basis of provided inputs can, when trained and validated, of course, can provide you in this case with an indication of a certain failure mechanism occurring. And the indication of the failure mechanism occurring here is a clogging of a flow transmitter, which is quite disturbing to the total process. So on the basis of data that is available at the flow loop in the data historian, and on the basis of events that were classified where the transmitter was being clogged by foaming and sediments, a model has been trained to actually recognize this condition and provide you with an early warning. And these PMML models you see here are just blocks on the pellets. You can drag and drop them and configure them and link them to the model that you would like them to be linked to. And that model is then trained and validated in an analysis environment. We can do that in a follow-up webinar, perhaps, to show you how you can train and validate these models and make them live. Looking at the time, I have about 30 minutes left. So there's a number of processing rules here that are specific to this example, but there's also a processing rule here that actually provides the user with a soft sensor, so a software-based sensor, which calculates once there's clogging on the flow transmitter, the diameter through which the flow goes reduces. It's an EMF meter, and as such, there is a measurement fold of the actual flow that is going through the meter, and this soft sensor is actually taking care of providing the right, the expected flow based on a model that has been trained under conditions where the loop was completely clean. We also have inside APM Studio an ability to run bowtie models. Bowtie models are cause consequence models, where on the left hand side we have causes that are followed by different tests determining if this cause is actually currently occurring. And we see here I selected flow transmitter 102. That there's currently a 30% chance of contamination and a 30% chance of fouling occurring. And the center here of the bow tie, the yellow knot, is actually the event that we want to predict, that we want to recognize early on, such that we can provide advisories to the user. So bow ties are cause-consequence models. Causes on the left-hand side, consequences on the right-hand side, which you can link to streaming data. You can link to streaming data like you could link the assets to streaming data as well. And then on the basis of that streaming data and models that you've defined and engineering rules, first principle rules that you have defined, you can run these models, and they provide you with an early notification, early insights into possible degradations that are happening on your assets. And this is then all visualized inside a dashboard, and or can be visualized inside a dashboard, where I already showed in the introduction that, you know, there's a dashboard behind here. But again, it's a low-code, no-code environment. If you would like to create dashboards, and you would like to have time series or pie charts, asset cards, model selectors, etc. Again, here we make it for the user very easy to define the different graphical components, event browsers, asset cards, etc., by providing an environment in which they can just drag and drop a time series chart and then configure its look and feel. And once you're happy with the look and feel, You can take it into live mode. I'm a super user, so I can do these things. You can take it into live mode, and the time series is actually presented or represented as you configured it, which is quite nice. With the capability, of course, also to do drill downs. For example, I just clicked on the focus view of the pump, so we get the pump, the flow transmitter that's directly associated to it. We see an overview of the health of the pump, the KPIs of the pump. And it's most of the time in the green area. It's not behaving. It's not doing very well. Let me put it this way. And you can have detailed views going into detail on the flow transmitters or whatever elements you have inside your system that you would like to focus on. It's quite comprehensive. And here, because I'm super user, we see on the left hand side all the capabilities to define a solution. But the dashboarding can be run on its own on a tablet, on a mobile phone, linking up to the APM server that is providing it with the data to render. Now, let me stop sharing my screen, and I'm a bit wary of the time. We had an hour, and see if there's any questions in the audience.
Yes, Jules. Actually, it's very exciting. I mean, participants have sent me some direct messages on their questions, and I would like to share them if it's okay.
Sure, absolutely.
All right. So with the learnings that we have heard so far, I have received some questions and would like to share them. Can you see my screen?
Yes, absolutely.
So the first question is, can I start a PDM project without the availability of a CMMS maintenance, work order, inspection, data, and the lack of a structured entry?
Yes. Yeah, we very often find that the data that is available, the quality of the data that's available in the maintenance management systems is not of the highest quality. So people don't enter the, for example, the problem, the cause, how to remediate it. People don't enter it because there's no structured way in doing this. There's an ISO standard 12224, I believe, that allows companies to provide very structured entries for problem causes and remediations of assets. And this is an area where a lot of companies still need to invest. So in those cases, we very often fall back on the available event and alarm data that your DCS or your SCADA system also logs, which is very often also not used to the full extent. And in combination with the failure mode and effect analysis that we've done, we identify what additional data needs to be either collected or manipulated from the systems to replace is the wrong word, but to substitute, I think is better, substitute the maintenance management system for the time that there is no high quality data in there yet. So the lack of structured entry is definitely an issue that we see, but it's not an issue that can actually blocks your CBM or PDM project.
All right, thank you, Jules. There's another question here that says, can we start with OEM predictive models as part of design digital twin that can be refined with data from commissioning and actual use of the critical equipment? Possibly IoT devices connected on critical equipment to collect the data to feed the model.
Yeah, so we work for a large number of OEMs. So we work with Cameron, with Siemens, Schlumberger, Halliburton, Krone, Samsung, Henderson Hauser, Ebro. We work with a lot of OEM companies. And for these OEM companies, we provide prognostics, predictive models, OEM predictive models. And you can start using those as, it's a very good starting point to start using those. But the way in which your assets is being used in your process is very often somewhat different from the OEM predictive model. So you have to tune and adjust it to the operational load and balance that you're putting onto it. Now, adding IoT devices to those critical equipment to collect data is a good strategy to follow if you do not have sufficient data available from your assets. So Let me take an example, of a compressor. Let's say you have a compressor that is critical, but you don't have acceleration measurements on the on the compressor, on the axles, etc., on the bearings, and you do need those to provide a good indication of alignment, misalignment, load, lubrication, etc. Then very often it's easy to place, and not too expensive anymore, additional devices, acceleration sensors, that allow you to collect the appropriate data from the assets. And in this area, especially in the area of acceleration sensors, in the past decade, you could say, the cost of these sensors have come down because of the different technologies that are used. It used to be piezo-based in the past, and now we have MEMS sensors and piezo still. These sensors have come down in cost quite drastically, but also in capability. So there's kinetic wireless vibration sensors, for example, that can be placed in quite corrosive environments. That allow you to collect data without having to put cabling in place, install additional hardware in the control cabinets, etc. So the possibilities in this area have really over the last years exploded tremendously in a positive way.
Thank you, Jules. The next question we have here is, do I need high frequency data from my assets? And I only have second data from my PI historian.
Well, you typically need high frequency data for rotating assets, and higher frequency data for rotating assets is required to identify, for example, the vibration spectrum and the leading the leading peaks in the vibration spectrum that indicate, for example, inner, outer, or ball wear and tear or lubrication issues. And that's an area where you need high frequency data. In this area, certain of the sensor manufacturers are actually providing the frequency spectrum as an output. So they do the FFT on chip, provide the frequency spectrum as an output, which takes away the requirement to have this high frequency data. And very often what we see when we start projects with our customers, with our partners, we always start with the data that we already have, which is in a PI historian or an IP21 or PhD, Exoquantum, et cetera. And of course there, very often there's only second base data because data is already aggregated to a large extent. So high frequency is data. Data is typically needed for rotating equipment, but if the sensors that are being used already provide you with frequency spectra, which is low frequency data, then it's a sufficient basis to start with.
Thank you. The next one is, what would be the first steps in moving towards PDM?
The very first step for us is always to understand the business case. And so we always start with understanding the business case, why a company would like to go down this path. And the business case can be driven by a value driver. That value driver could be related to efficiency, unplanned downtime, prolonging plant maintenance intervals. There's typically a value driver. And from the business case, we identify the different use cases that we want to focus on. And that's really the first step, which is then followed by typically what we do is an MVP or a POC type approach, where on the basis of the business case and the use cases, we do a data collection and a first scan, data scan of the data that's available to determine if the criteria set forth in the business case can also be met. So the criteria could be having, for example, a week ahead of time indication of specific failure mechanisms or failure modes on assets, or a criteria could be prolonging the PM, the plant maintenance interval, by 20%.
All right. Then I have three more questions here, if it's okay. I know we're
heading on.
Okay. So the next one is, how can I pinpoint if PDM is for my company, or perhaps I'm better off with another maintenance strategy?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So how to determine if predictive maintenance is the right strategy for your company? So let me start by saying that predictive maintenance for all the assets at your site or at your company is typically not something that is achievable. It's not achievable because you may not have the data to do so. It can be, it could be quite costly to distribute it across all your assets. So in the presentation, I had this graph with the four quadrants. And on the basis of the failure mechanisms and the failure modes, frequencies of failure, and the cost or the risk associated with it, we identify the areas which are related to assets or components of assets that you can focus on with real-time condition-based or predictive maintenance programs. And it's not the case that a company goes from a preventive maintenance program towards doing everything condition-based or everything predictive on their total asset base. There's always a mixture. So you will always continue to doing preventive maintenance on those assets which for which you have overcapacity or a parallel stream, i.e. redundancy. And very often on the critical assets, the assets that matter that are in the bloodline of your process, you start rolling out real-time condition-based and predictive maintenance.
All right. Then the other one is, are there freeware, free software that can collect data and display data dashboards from IoT devices?
There are, yeah. Grafana is one of the ones that I think is most known to everywhere. I mean, if we're in Latin America or in Europe or Eastern Europe or in Malaysia, we come across Grafana, which is a freeware, open source software that allows you to set up data collection to AMQP streams and then do data visualizations as well, dashboarding. There's also, maybe to pinpoint out, open source software, and we prefer KNIME in this case, KNIME, which is software that allows you to do data analysis, train machine learning models and validate machine learning models, and then export them to PMML. So there are some freeware alternatives, absolutely. They're not as versatile as the dashboards that I just showed. They do require some programming, scripting to make them work.
Right. And on to our last question. How could you reasons APM Studio integrate with other platforms that my organization uses?
Yeah, so we have typically from the field upwards, we have interfaces such as OPC UA, MQTT, AMQP, and different specific interfaces to vendor protocols. And then northbound integration to other platforms, other systems that your organization uses. We have REST interfaces, so we are agnostic to other systems in the environment, so we can quite easily integrate with SAP or with Maximo or with Ultimo, for example. We can quite easily integrate with your data historians as well using REST-based interfaces, so the web API, for example, for OCSoft Spy. And if you go to the clouds, we're also agnostic with respect to different cloud interfaces where we have infrastructure components to go to Azure IoT, to AWS, and to Watson, which was used to be called Bluemix in the past by IBM.
Great. I think that is the last question that we have. And I guess, you know, we're a little bit over time, but thank you, Jules, for extending your time with us. We are very grateful. And thank you for being with us on this. And if you have any questions or you have forgotten to ask the question, you can always reach out to us by our contact details at info@erudite.com.ph. I'll put that on the chat box, and we would like to hear your experience. So please help us know about your experience by filling out our short evaluation form that you can find in our chat room. So ladies and gentlemen, we would like to thanks Jules again. Can we get this time to give Jules a big round of applause for a good for this time and learning that we have learned, and we would hope to be of service to your organization in the future. We will be posting the next schedule of our webinar as mentioned by Jules. The topic of that, Jules, as you said, were about...
I think it's going from the data that you have with some examples, some practical examples, showing how you can pre-process that data and then turn that data into a pipeline that allows you to train machine learning models and then deploy those machine learning models. I think that would be great. So we know about what data we need, and then we can go from the data to an actual example of doing the analysis on the data and then deploying that as a model that runs 24/7 on the data streams.
Perfect, perfect. So we've reached our end of our webinar, and we would like to thank everyone for all your time and your being with us, your participation to the poll and your questions. So for now, we'd like to say thank you again and take care, everyone. Keep safe. And Jules, thank you very much. We say in the Philippines, maraming salamat.
You're welcome. I need to learn how to say you're welcome.
Yes, maraming salamat.
Maraming salamat.
Yeah, perfect. All right. So okay. Keep safe and till the next webinar. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.